Cuckold by Kiran Nagarkar. Cuckold by Kiran Nagarkar, book review, Toastmaster Yash.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. Good evening, President, dear guests, and my fellow Toastmasters. What comes to your mind when you hear the word cuckold? I guess something not very decent. What seems like an erotica is actually a Sahitya Academy award-winning book by Kiran Nagarkar. The feelings of being a cuckold or being cuckolded has been described by various authors in length in various literatures. But imagine a situation wherein the one committing infidelity is not denigrated by the society but is rather applauded and celebrated. And the one cuckolding is not a mere human mortal but the blue immortal god Krishna. You guessed it correct. We are talking about a novel which is a historical fiction set in early 16th century. This book is loosely based upon the lives of Maharana Sangram Singh of Chittor, his son Bhojraj Singh, and his daughter-in-law, the little saint Mirabai. Little is known in history about Bhojraj Singh, and the author is very apt to choose his life to write fiction upon. The book, in fact, is the memoir of Bhojraj Singh. Bhojraj Singh here is portrayed as Maharaj Kumar or the Crown Prince. Now, Maharaj Kumar is a very able administrator. He is someone who prefers building sewer systems for his citizens rather than building victory towers or known as Vijay Stambhs. As a very able administrator and a wise statesman, he refrains from acting upon impulse. Rather, he is portrayed as someone who thinks ahead of his time. He is not very heroic as his father Sangram Singh, but as a brilliant master strategist who prefers to win over his enemies by playing upon the fears of their mind. He is everything what a modern citizen could demand from an administrator. Let's talk about his wife. His wife is never once named in this entire book. She is always referred to as princess, green eyes, and many other epithets, but never her name. Now, talking about her, she on the first night, that is after the wedding night, refuses her crown prince. See, I am betrothed to someone else. I will not consummate marriage with you. Hearing this, prince is in fury. He feels humiliated. He also feels emasculated. But it is very strange, he is also very much attracted to his wife. This is surprising, for the Rajput rulers do not bear such kind of insults. He pressurizes his wife to reveal the name of the lover. After much prodding and much pressurizing, she finally reveals it is Krishna. He wonders, is she lying? Who loves the god of myths? But one day, he finds her ecstatic state meditating upon Krishna, and then he comes to terms with it. Now the point is, his Krishna is also his role model since childhood, because Krishna is master strategist of Mahabharata, and he is fond of strategy. Now as the realization dawns upon him, he feels betrayed not only by his wife, but also his god. In the entire book, there is a feeling of despair over husband not having his rights or not having his rights over his wife. The only way he feels he can come to terms or he can come close to his wife by himself pretending to be Krishna only then. Meanwhile, Rana Sangram Singh is fighting the Sultan of Gujarat for the throne of Idar. While he is away, he makes Maharaj Kumar the ruler of Chittor. Now this infuriates his stepmother, Rani Karmavati, and her son Vikramaditya. To tell you, Vikramaditya is pampered and spoiled prince. Now, interesting point here is, the villain in this entire novel is not Krishna. It is not Sultan of Gujarat, nor for that matter Babar. It is Vikramaditya. Now, court intrigues by Vikramaditya and Rani Karmavati force Maharaj Kumar to leave Chittor and to take charge of the fight with Sultan of Gujarat. What had been a battle raging since years ends in the matter of 6 months because of intervention of Maharaj Kumar. Now he is much loved by the army, by the chiefs. But upon returning to Chittor,
he is not applauded. He is rather excited by the Maharana to Kumbhalgarh. It is in this calm and quiet of Kumbhalgarh, he pretends to be his cuckold of Krishna and is finally able to come closer to his wife. Now the scene changes in the novel. The rage and aggression towards Krishna is suddenly transformed where a political scene of Mewar takes the center stage. Maharana realizes his mistakes. He calls back Maharaj Kumar and promptly dispatches him to lead the war against Sultan of Malwa. Deftly, Maharaj Kumar leads 4,000 men against 50,000 men of Sultan of Malwa plus Sultan of Gujarat combined, and he captures Sultan of Malwa, brings him back to Chittor. But something has taken change meanwhile. In the northern frontier, the king of Kabul, the king of Afghanistan, Babur, has defeated Ibrahim Lodi. It is now the turn of Rajput Confederacy to face the Mughal. The book ends with the graphic description of the Battle of Khanwa between Rana Sanga and Babur. The details of use of cannons and muskets by Babur and the havoc that takes place in the Rajput ranks is vividly described by the author. Something surprisingly, where Maharaj Kumar is described as very intelligent war strategist, in this last battle, he is depicted as ordinary dimwit falling prey to machinations of Babur. This seems somewhat out of place with his character. I guess the author here falls prey to the actual history rather than relying upon his fiction. All in all, this book is successful in recreating the scenes of Mewar in the times and era of Maharana Sangram Singh. Various scenes of the history which often feel very dry suddenly come to life in this book. The narrative is interspersed with the jealousy, infidelity, incest and scandals to color the picture of Mewar, the scenes of Mewar. All in all, I recommend this book as a very good read, not only as a novel which focuses upon competition for love, but also as a page-turning history thriller. Thank you. Over to you, the Toastmaster.